Good morning, dear students. I'm so glad to be with you through this Margadarshi Spandana. It is our privilege to take you through the second PU English paper, which is actually pending for the examination. I know second PUC students must be really worried about as to how to go about it and what to do. Of course, the motivation is quite low because you have not touched your books for so many days together, and you are wondering as to if there's some magic would happen that somebody could come and teach you some important questions and like you'll be through it. That's exactly what we are going to do. We are going to take you through all those portions, or not all really all of them, but the ones which are to be dealt upon. We'll be taking you through that important questions, important chapters, of course the grammar portion included, and you will be going through this Margadarshi Spandana. There will be 2 hours, and these 2 jam-packed hours will be yours if you take charge of those hours and make use of it promptly. Of course, you need to have a book and a pen with you and have just a recap of the content, and then maybe you are ready for the examination. So coming to the point here, actually, I hope we remember what was the target for second PUC. Most probably my target, if it would have been, if I was there in front of you, somewhere around 596, that's a magic number I call it, wherein all the 4 core subjects can be gone, you can take 100 out of 100 there, and then the remaining Hindi might have happened by now, maybe with the 98, and English, wow, see, English is there straight in front of you for 100, and the 100 I'm challenging you, because this package what you're going through, you will be literally going through what is important and how you're supposed to go through it. So we literally invite you to go through all these sessions and make use of it, and feel comfortable at the at your own home. Stay home and just go through these 2 hours every day from 9th to 16th, and then here it is, your examination, and you're like, it's a piece of cake for you. Fine. So coming to the thought here, I think hopefully the target is set that you'll be doing well for the examination. Of course, it's going to be an added bonus for the the coming results. This year again, we need to understand, because of the time lapse, the next colleges which you'll be taking on will be really challenging. So obviously prepare yourself very well and get some more information about what is career, what is that interest in your career, and how you can go further, and then accordingly you can prepare. So to talk about all those chapters and maybe the question paper in particular, we are looking at a 100 mark question paper, wherein it is distributed between 50 marks theory and 50 marks prose and the textbook rather, and the 50 marks is on the grammar, wherein textbook content might have got into your system by now. We have taught you throughout the year, the stories hopefully are remembered, if not you will remember this through these sessions, but then what is very important is the grammar portion. It takes a 50 marks for you. It's really very much possible. See, wherever I've been teaching, I have been teaching almost 10 years plus now for English, second PUC English, and what I feel is it's literally easy, provided you literally fall into that framework and do what is required, and accordingly you flourish. If it is grammar, if I'm talking about, my focus will be completely on to the reported speech, which is going to cut at least half marks for you. So have a open mind when you learn about reported speech, as well when you look at the speech writing, even that's going to challenge you, because there they will not give you easily 5 full marks. Even I would not have given. I want it in such a juicy way. The method, there is a method, that's what we're going to take you through, and then other parts of maybe linker will be little more extra exercise required. All those things will be taken care here. They'll be telling you exactly what can be done and how you can go about it, and you can take your stand on this is what is the marks I'm going to take. And coming to the prose or the textbook part of it, what we are looking at is full 50 marks spread out there. And my food for thought for you today is actually please hang on to those 14 chapters for 1 mark question. I think you might have had enough question banks with you by now. You might have had enough practice on those 1 mark questions. I don't know, maybe it's faded away, but then what you have to remember is these 12 marks in the question paper, the first 12 marks, and they're going to give you a good impression, like, okay, fine, good confidence, okay, fine, I can do well in the examination. This is a flow with which you're supposed to go for your exam paper. So when I say all these 12 marks questions, your 14 lessons will fall into picture. And please read through the textbook once. I think this is one suggestion I'm going to give you today, because I'll be sharing lots of tips with you throughout the session. For only for today, I think it is good time to start reading. Of course, we are going to touch upon Romeo and Juliet for you today. So a good base as it is, start reading the text, have a niche of what is there and what is not there, and just underline the points which is required to be. One lesson per day would do. Maybe, you know, it will get over by even before 1 or 2 days, because poem needs literally 5 to 6 minutes of reading. So that textbook part, please have a hang on and please get through the textbook. Lesson reading once is a must. I think any teacher you speak to, that's the only way out. 1 mark question is the textbook reading. That one homework you may have to do. Other than that, everything will be taken care here. We will be giving you the summary of almost all the lessons which are there for the examination, which are important for the examination, as well as we'll be looking at those important questions where you'll be jotting upon, where you're supposed to do, how you're supposed to do. I think each and every answer, question answer session also will give enough tips will be given to you, and accordingly you prepare yourself. So here we are, Romeo and Juliet for today. I think it's an evergreen story which is never forgotten, and every time somebody tells it, you want to listen to it like, wow, this is a story. So Professor Rajni, yes ma'am, will be giving a recap of the whole lesson for you. Enjoy the story. With that, recollect back as to, oh, this was a story, this was a question, and this was the content to be remembered. So let's take up Romeo and Juliet for today, and let's begin. All the best to you students. Have a nice class.
Hello dear friends, we will be starting with the first poem in your chapter, in your book Streams, with Romeo and Juliet by William Shakespeare. We all know Shakespeare is the father of English literature. His time, though it is suspicious, we don't know anything clearly about him. His time is noted to be somewhere between 1564 to 1616. So it's almost 4 centuries, almost 400 years that we have been learning Shakespeare, yet he stands as number one in English literature. And one of his best tragedies ever was Romeo and Juliet, which was the birth of love for human beings. All this started with Romeo and Juliet. Let us talk slightly about Romeo and Juliet and learn what the story actually tells us about. Romeo and Juliet were two small children, adolescent children in fact, of two major rival families from Verona. Verona was a place, was a city in Italy, Rome. And these two families, they were supposed to be the prestigious families of Verona, the Montagues and the Capulets. From the Capulet family, Juliet came out, and Romeo belonged to the Montagues family. They both were not aware that these two were enemy family kids. They did not even see each other. In fact, it was this way, the other. Romeo, he was in madly love with Juliet's cousin, Rosaline. Rosaline was Juliet's cousin, and Romeo fell for Rosaline and her beauty. In fact, it could also be called as a crush. It was not actual love at all for him. Romeo wanted to meet Rosaline every now and then, whereas Rosaline was against it. She never wanted Romeo to be behind her any time. It so happened that from the Capulet family, Juliet's father, that is Lord Capulet, he hosts a party. And this party, usually in their custom, it is called as the ball dance. He hosts a ball dance, and people from far and wide were invited to it, except anybody from the Montague family, because they were staunch rivals. Nobody from Capulet family wanted the Montagues to come into that family at all. But Romeo, who understood that there would be a secret ball here, there would be a dance of this kind, he came out to this ball in disguise. In disguise, wearing mask, he comes and he attends the ball, the dance program. His intention was to meet Rosaline, Juliet's cousin. But God and destiny was something else. He did not meet Rosaline. In fact, he fell for the beauty of Juliet. He liked Juliet very much. And at first sight itself, he was madly in love with her. He wanted to know what was Juliet's feeling for her. Her beauty mesmerized him. Juliet also doesn't know that he is Romeo and he is from Montague family. Slightly, slowly, one after the other meeting, they meet, they are fond of each other, they like each other, and they strongly are in love with each other. Of course, as usual, this is an adolescent love, which never could be serious, which never could be taken seriously by the parents and by the family members. Romeo and Juliet, further the story goes on, and they are opposed by the families. Both of them, in their innocence, naivety, they go pray as for their own mistakes that they have done, for all the silly things that they plan, and they give up their life. That's the rest of the story. What we have to learn here in Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet is decisions taken by adolescents can slightly be disastrous. That is what we are going to learn in this poem, Romeo and Juliet. More than the decisions, more than Shakespeare, anything about the true love or the not true love, we have to understand the beauty of language in this poem. Shakespeare, in this poem, enormously beautifully, he explains the beauty of Juliet. And this poem that is prescribed to us in the second POC, it is filled with similes. And all these similes, the decorative language, the beauty of this language can be easily understood. Romeo and Juliet's beauty here in this poem, Juliet's beauty is exemplified, is given with examples with lot and lots of similes. And when it comes to Juliet's verse, we can see lots of personification, wherein the sky is personified, star is personified, night also is personified to a very young and handsome gentleman. That is what has to be understood in Romeo and Juliet. Having learned the introduction about Romeo and Juliet, let us move on to the 10-12 lines that have been given to us to study. These are the verses of madly in love with Juliet, the great hero Romeo. He describes, he sees Juliet during the ball dance. He sees her, he's mesmerized by the beauty, he likes her very much. It's almost like how me and you talk about the love at first sight for him. He falls for her and he wants to appreciate her beauty. Till then, Romeo's identity was hidden. He did not want anybody from the Capulet family to know that it is Romeo from the enemy family. But in his madness for love, he openly discloses his feelings, and that will lead to the further problems. That is there in the story. But what is exactly described here is this. Romeo, as soon as he sees Juliet, he says, "Oh, she definitely teaches the torches to burn bright." It is Romeo's verses, imagination, that torches burn brightly only looking at Juliet's beauty. The torches are scared. They are, in fact, motivated to burn brighter, just like Juliet's beauty. So he says, she is the one who teaches the torches to burn bright. And he also explains that she is like the golden jewel on the cheek of the night. Please understand the personification here. Night is personified as a human being having cheeks, and then she is like that golden earring, and also like the rich jewel in Ethiop's ear. Ethiopian, a dark complexioned African on whom the golden earrings glitter. On the dark background, we have the golden earrings, which give added gloss, added beauty to these golden earrings. So Juliet's beauty is compared to this rich jewel in the Ethiop's ear. He continues to say that her beauty is too rich to use even to exaggerate, use even to explain, use even to describe. Her beauty is too rich, it is very expensive to be used even to compare with somebody else. Even after his imagination is, even if after the ball he goes back home, he wants to tell somebody how beautiful she was, it is an expensive one. He shouldn't be using her beauty every now and then to explain to others how beautiful she was. So that is what he tries to say when he means it is too rich to use. He doesn't want that beauty to be every now and then used to compare with others. He also further goes on and tells that Juliet is just like that snowy dove. Dove is a pigeon, is a lovebird, a white, beautiful bird, which is snowy. It's as white as snow. That bird, it is trooping amongst other birds, just like crows. You all can imagine a group of crows, a troop of crows. Amidst that, a beautiful dove bird, a beautiful snowy dove. And Juliet is compared like that. See, Juliet is seen by Romeo getting down the steps with all that neat and beautiful dress. She comes down the steps into the dance, into the ballroom. And then when she is coming down here, he sees and then he feels. There are her friends who are surrounding her. And that scene, he feels that Juliet is the snowy dove. And her friends are similar to crows. He only notices Juliet and her beauty. And therefore, these verses come out. She is just like the snowy dove amidst the crows. He further explains and he says that after all the measure is done, measure here refers to the dance that is done, measure here refers to the comparison and explanation of beauty by him, whatever he is doing. After all this is done, after the measure done, he would go and stand in one place, the place of stand, and then just watch her, fallen completely for her. He wants to watch. He doesn't want to talk, nothing. If given a chance, he would again come back and try to dance with her. And then he feels that his hands would be blessed. His hands would be blessed even when by chance, by mistake, by chance, if his hands touch hers. And he feels that his rough and rude hand, they would be really blessed just by touching her. And that was the mad love for him. So he feels, measure done. I'll go quietly stand. I don't want to talk anything. I don't want to lose out the experience that I have got of enjoying seeing her beauty. He just wants to stand. And by chance, he gets a chance to dance. His hands would be blessed. And then he questions himself, did my heart ever love? Then he questions about all these things that has happened to him. We all know that he was madly in love with Rosaline. I am writing this in red because this one doesn't come anywhere at all later on. Rosaline was the person for whom Romeo had come. She was the dam. She was the girl for whom he had fallen. But once looking at Juliet, his heart is completely gone into Juliet's beauty. His mind completely forgets Rosaline. So he questions himself, did my heart ever love anybody till now? I think all those feelings that I had initially was just a simple kiddish and a childish love. From now on, probably, I've completely fallen for Juliet. And that is for him, for Romeo, true love. Therefore, he thinks, yes, this is beauty. We have understood that there are so many similes here. We have seen similes like here, torches being asked to burn bright. That is one simile. Simile is something like, comparison. When we compare two things in the English literature, in those languages, it is called a simile. When you compare two things, that is called as a simile. Torches being asked to burn bright because of Juliet's beauty. That is one simile. Cheek of the night, and she is compared to cheek of night, and she is the rich jewel in Ethiopia. Jewel, beauty of Juliet is compared to a jewel. And the other atmosphere is the Ethiop's ear. So again, we have comparison, and Juliet's beauty is compared to the rich jewel. She is also the best simile here is the snowy dove amidst the crows. This is the best example can anyone give for a simile. She is just like her beauty. Juliet herself is just like that beautiful white dove bird amidst the crows. And this is also a simile that we have seen. Hands being blessed is just another word. There is no simile here at all. These three similes are very important. And whenever we have the summary that has to be written, whenever we have the answers that we have to be written regarding Romeo and Juliet, please, dear students, keep in mind, you need to underline these words that you write. You need to use these words from the poem. You need to write down all these things and highlight them. Only when you highlight it like this, write and then underline this, I feel your answers will be complete. They actually capture the attention of the evaluator, and therefore you are sure to get more marks and better marks. So these are the similes that we can see in Romeo's verses for Juliet. Next we have Juliet's verses for Romeo, which is completely filled with personification.